So, welcome to today's presentation of Personal Learning Networks, because being your best is a choice. It's presented by me, Paige Bradenkamp, the School Library Consultant at Wyoming State Library. And a little later in the show, we will have a special guest, which is Thomas Ivey, and we'll talk about him in just a little bit. To begin with, I want to lay a little background. As most people might be familiar with networks, but why networks? Why is it so important now to be part of a network? Networking is a constructivist approach to learning. We know that knowledge is formed through interactions and experiences. And this isn't limited to students, but adults, and especially professional adults, need to connect as well. Learning is based on interaction and sharing and conversation and participation. And in that way, we can build our knowledge. We can build on our ideas and get fresh ideas to stay motivated and inspired. We're all familiar with the concept of networking and the benefits of connecting with people that share our interests. There is great value in communicating with others, in sharing ideas, and learning about issues facing other professionals. Some of those issues may even be the same or similar issues that you are experiencing in your own districts. Having support in times of budget crises, when you're facing reconsideration challenges, or when the school board is looking to cut library positions, can help ease anxiety and furnish you with ideas to help you and your library. And perhaps it's a matter of you need to brush up on some skills in the library world, or you want to learn some of the new ways that librarians are handling their collections. Networking helps you get that experience and that knowledge. So what is a personal learning network? A personal learning network is a group of people connecting around a common interest or field to share ideas, inspiration, and experiences. This is often done via social media or other digital means. This differs from professional learning networks in that you actually create your own network. Being a school librarian, you're often put into professional learning networks by your administrators, and perhaps you are told to meet with a content area teaching group or a grade level teaching group. And so your administration puts you into a professional learning network. There is value in that, but the personal learning network differs in that you get to choose the network that you connect with. Personal learning networks help you keep current with the education world and school library advocacy. Again, it is your own network that you can choose. It can help you develop your skills, abilities, and ideas. This can consist of your Pinterest boards, blogs that you like to follow, or podcasts that you listen to. It could simply be a newsletter that you sign up to receive, such as Class Tech Tips or Common Sense Education. It could be the newsletter that you receive from me, the school library consultant. That is part of a network. The difference that we're going to talk about here is intentionality. When you set out to develop a network, you are being very intentional about it. You are finding connections that specifically address skills or knowledge that you want to develop. Sharing is not a new concept, but with the internet and other digital technology, our opportunities have greatly expanded. Even when physical conferences are out of the question, we can still be a part of the global brain. And just to be clear, I'm not saying that physical conferences are no longer valid, because they definitely are. But with all of these new technologies and digital tools, we have way more opportunities to network and to stay connected, not just in a local area, but globally. School librarians are often solo, operating alone in a building or a district, and personal learning networks connect you with others in your field. Networking lets you explore and experience the knowledge of others that can be so inspiring and keep the fire lit that is so necessary in teaching. How many of you already go to websites, Pinterest, and Twitter to find ideas and inspiration? How many of you already follow people on those apps or others? You are already developing your personal learning network. Again, it's the difference between intentionally developing your network and just setting out and finding things that are interesting. When you are intentionally seeking out others who support, encourage, and challenge your learning, you're taking charge and directing the professional that you become or continue to be. And going back to the idea of physical conferences and physical networking, that's all very valid, but as school librarians, we have seen a decline in the opportunities to go to conferences. And so digital tools help us continue to network. However, there are still a lot of opportunities to go to conferences. And here in Wyoming, we have our own school library conference each year, and that is the Information Power Conference. And that consists fully of school librarians. And this year it is connected to the Wyoming Library Association Annual Conference. This takes place in August, August 9th, 10th, and 11th. Just a short plug there for our annual conference. But moving on to our special guest, Thomas Ivey, who is a master networker, and he has some tips and ideas for networking. Again, this is something that, these are ideas that you can take with you when you go to the Wyoming Library Association Conference, or if you're in another state, you can take to your own Library Association Conference or School Library Conference. So, Thomas Ivey, I have here sitting next to me. He does work here at the Wyoming State Library, but he's going to talk today a little bit about networking. Thomas, would you like to say hi?
Hi.
Right. So, Thomas, how do you like to network?
Well, I like to meet people face-to-face, but also when you're on a listserv, you know, you see certain people tend to post more often than others, and maybe you like their ideas and you want to connect with them. Events. You go to an event. Like, take for instance the legislative reception that we do here at the Wyoming State Library.
Oh, that's each year in February, right?
Yeah.
And what happens there?
Well, you get to meet with other librarians and staff throughout the state, and they can be from academic libraries, special libraries, public libraries, school librarians. But you get to meet legislators.
That's very important.
And elected officials. So you might have a meaningful conversation with somebody and you spark up, you know, that connection, and you want to grow that network using those types of connections.
That also helps in advocating for your library.
Exactly.
Oh, that is. So not only are you networking to get ideas, but you're also networking to support your profession.
Yes.
Awesome.
Meetings. Let's say you're on a committee and you haven't met some of these people before, or at a conference as well. You know, we talk about in-person conferences, but there's online conferences as well.
That's true.
You might enjoy a particular presenter and want to try and add them into your network.
You know, that is exactly how I came across Joyce Valenza. She is a well-known name in the school library field, and I heard her presenting at a virtual conference that I was in my office listening to, and since then I have started to follow her blog, and I have enjoyed several webinars that she has presented. So that's a great idea.
Good. I tend to collect business cards.
Yeah.
And I don't know why, but when I go places and I exchange cards, then when I come back, I will go through those and review, because sometimes they're vendors, you know, and you may or may not want to add them to your professional network, kind of depending on your needs. And they're pretty free at handing out their business cards. So
whether or not it pertains
right
to you.
I like to use LinkedIn
mm-hmm.
to make those connections, because I've only come across a couple instances where someone wasn't on LinkedIn. That's the most well-known for professional connections.
Okay.
I don't use Facebook for my professional. I know some people add anybody and everybody to their mm-hmm. Facebook, but I don't do that.
Well, that's probably wise, seeing as sometimes we post very personal things on Facebook, and maybe we don't want that necessarily being connected to our professional lives.
Right, and people can share things if your settings are a certain way, you know, and
mm-hmm.
then that can be embarrassing and not something that you can control if that happens. So
very true. Why do you feel that networking is important?
Well, you can see what organizations other people follow. Like if you're on LinkedIn, there's ways that you know you can see who they're connected with as far as organizations. You can as well as people sometimes, but I don't think that's a great idea. But the organizations, I do think, is a good idea. Some organizations are more active than others on LinkedIn as far as what they produce and put out. Some are just stagnant.
Okay.
So you add one or two at a time and see if they produce things that you can use in your professional development. Some put out articles. You can also, you know, sometimes a network connection might have a link to their blog, their professional blog,
mm-hmm.
and you can, you know, they'll post when there's new update or something to it. So you
nice.
Can go there and do some professional reading. I like to use it for reading that is outside of library. So, but that might pertain to libraries.
Okay. Can you give us an example?
Well, for myself, anything motivational.
Oh,
leadership.
Yes. Excellent.
There's a lot of leadership type things in the public sector, in the private sector.
Mm-hmm. I think I can always use motivational.
Oh yeah, I think we all can. And, you know, sometimes organizations that have to do with sales, that could be pertinent to your patrons or your customers. If you're in a school library, maybe it is dealing with, you know, kids or teens, young adults.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very good point.
So
what are some things to watch out for when you're trying to make these network connections?
Well, for me personally, I get a lot of people that try to add me to their network that I've never met.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of times they're salespeople.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they're trying. There are people out there that just want to see how many connections they can have, you know,
uh-huh.
to build the numbers up. On a personal level, I don't add them unless I've done business with them or I know of them, and I feel it would be advantageous to to me, mm-hmm. to have them as a connection, because you can, your connections, you can run ideas off of them, mm-hmm. Especially if you've met them and they know who you are, mm-hmm. you know, it's easier to do that.
Yeah.
If it's a vendor, you know, are they going to try and sell me something?
Yeah.
So, yeah. And as libraries, we usually don't have lots of extra money to be able to buy things.
No, so. I've noticed that.
Yeah.
Okay, and let's go back to the business card thing. What if you don't have business cards?
Well, you know, everybody seems like has some kind of social media.
Mm-hmm.
So you can make your own business cards if you don't have any. They're really easy to make. You can get there's Microsoft Word template,
mm-hmm.
that, you know,
and
you don't have to put your phone number on it or anything like that. It's got your name, you know. If you want them to follow your Instagram, you put that on there, or your LinkedIn, or, you know, okay. whatever connection, however you want to make that connection. But it's simple to do, low budget,
mm-hmm.
doesn't have to be on super heavy card stock. Even I've seen business cards that are all different shapes and sizes, so if mm-hmm. you don't cut it straight.
Well, and so if you know you're going to a conference or something, you could
make some up real quick. Yeah, you betcha.
And especially some of those conferences I've been to where you just drop your business card in a bowl and they have drawings, that would be really handy.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah.
That's a great idea. So even if you don't have business cards and you know you're going to a conference, you can just make some up and have them for that conference. That's a great idea.
Yeah.
So those are some tips for physical conferences and physical face-to-face trainings and meetings, which are all very important, so along with our social media.
Another thing I think is really good for when you're networking is to be able to use these connections for collaboration.
Oh, that's great.
So let's say you've located a grant,
uh-huh.
but it's a bigger project than something that you can take on.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you could work with one of your connections.
Excellent.
Or maybe several of the connections, and you can work together,
mm-hmm.
and each has a piece of that grant.
Oh, that's a great
idea. I mean, there's a lot of different ways you can use these networks. Like I said before, you can run ideas and questions by the people in your networks, and I find that advantageous because I have people ask me as well. So you've got this back and forth of ideas, and you know, somebody on the listserv, a listserv that's got tons of experience, they're a good person, and that's a listserv could be your network.
Okay, yeah.
You know, there's people that are members of that listserv,
mm-hmm.
and you've networked just by participating in that.
That's so true.
And they're easy to sign up for,
mm-hmm.
easy to find, you know, so you don't get overwhelmed. Some of them offer a digest, so you don't get 100 emails a day, you know, mm-hmm. you get one,
mm-hmm.
and you can scroll through it, through the table of contents, and maybe nothing applies to you that day, mm-hmm. you know.
The ISTE does that, they offer the digest, which is very handy.
And Coslick?
Coslick does, yeah. Another great way to network as well, and we were talking about this earlier, is when there is a local conference, actually participating in the conference, right?
Right.
I mean, like actually doing a presentation, doing a session, and sharing your knowledge and getting ideas from the participants in that session. This is a great way to put yourself out there for those bold spirits. But it is a great way to help develop connections. instead of not attending, or and it's okay to just go and attend the sessions, but sometimes you might have a really strong idea about something, or you've tried something and it worked really well and you want to share that. That is a great way to develop your professional network and your personal learning network. So we also have an opportunity for that for Wyoming librarians coming up at the Wyoming Library Association Conference that I plugged a little bit earlier. And something as simple as doing a 2-minute presentation, in our case, doing What the Tech, and that just highlights different technology that is useful to you. Getting involved in things like that is very important and can help just develop that network, those connections. Thomas, I know that you're in charge of that particular program. Would you like to speak to that at all?
Well, as far as networking goes, you know, it's kind of a lightning round situation, which is kind of fun because at the end of your time, a buzzer goes off or whatever.
Uh-huh, fun.
You know, and
so you got to be quick.
And sometimes you get cut off. So everybody's having a good time, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's our most popular program at WLA, or at least I'd like to think so. And people remember you.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's a fun thing, and they're like,
yeah.
"Oh yeah, you're the one that presented on that, and you got cut off." Ah, you know, and that opens the door for that network.
That's right. That is so important, especially where school librarians are often isolated in their buildings. Just getting out, even if you go to the conference once a year, you know, which it is an annual conference, the Information Power Conference and the WLA Conference, you know, where they're connected this year, it's one conference. But even doing that once a year still helps build a presence in the minds of other people. And when other people are looking for ideas, they're going to remember you, and vice versa. You're going to remember somebody, if you're in Cheyenne, you'll remember somebody from Jackson who talks about Google and has great skills with that. You know, that's really important throughout the rest of your year when you have questions or you want to try something. So thank you, Thomas, for that. That was really wonderful. I'm glad you were able to join me today.
You're welcome.
So here are some tools for developing your PLN. I have bolded those that are Wyoming state specific, but things like Paperly and Pinterest, those are content creation tools, Google Plus community, Twitter, EdCamps. You might find EdCamps online. You might find EdCamps around. In different towns. Keep your eyes open for those. Those are informal idea sharing events. LinkedIn, School Library Journal, Day of Dialogue, that happens once a year in the spring. Common Sense Education, that website is Common Sense, but then they also have the Common Sense Education Edition. And they have newsletters. Very, very good website to be a part of. Because they do talk about different tools and different opportunities, and they rate tools, digital learning tools. They offer lesson plans, things like that. Really great website to be familiar with. Then we also have the GoWild.net blog, and that's a blog about all the things happening with GoWild.net. Our consortium of databases, research tools, and ebooks. Wyoming Library Association School Library Listserv. That is an example of a listserv that Thomas was talking about, and this one's dedicated to school librarians. And if you are on that listserv, you get the emails that go out to school librarians, and other school librarians can post on it. That's also where the newsletter that I produce goes out on. Wyoming State Library Continuing Education Calendar. That's a great tool for professional development. It is a calendar that's put out at the end of each month for the following month. and it highlights free professional development opportunities that are given via webinars. So you can find some that are connected and relevant to what you're looking for, and they're free. So you can sign up for it and attend that webinar, or most of them actually archive their webinars. Like my webinar will also be archived. But so you can find some really great professional development webinars on that calendar. Just visit the Wyoming State Library website and you'll find that. We have a library blog and a Facebook page at the Wyoming State Library. The Information Power, this year it's a pre-conference connected to the Wyoming Library Association annual conference. Those are some state-specific professional and personal learning network opportunities. Teachers First is a website that offers a lot of tips, tools, and highlights events that are relevant. Class Tech Tips, Monica Burns. Blue Skunk Blog, Doug Johnson, writes about school libraries and issues in school libraries. He is a school librarian. A lot of great insight, and he's humorous to read as well. Cult of Pedagogy is a website that also offers podcasts on education issues. YOED Chat is a Wyoming-specific Twitter chat that takes place every 2 weeks. Anyways, you can look that up. That's a very interesting chat. And I say Wyoming-specific, but if you're not from Wyoming, you can also get in on that. It's open to anybody. Feedly is a RSS feed. That's where all of my networking articles, journals, things like that I like to stay updated on. That's where those go to, and then it just collates everything for me. It organizes those articles that come in, so then I can go to Feedly and read it. So that's an organizing tool. Evernote is also an organizing tool. I can clip articles and web pages that I read, and I can clip it and store it in Evernote and have it for a future reference. And then, of course, we have our University of Wyoming Learning Resource Center. If you're not in Wyoming, you know, look to your local university, college, community college. They often have resources, especially if they have an education program. They have libraries. Every campus has a library, so that's also a good resource. But the University of Wyoming has the Learning Resource Center, and the blog there. There's the Twitter account and the blog that you can follow and find out about their resources and develop that, because UW has a great connection to all the libraries in Wyoming, and so they're a very valuable networking tool there. So, and it looks like we are coming to the end of our time, so I want to thank you for joining me, and here's some contact information, including my Twitter account. Feel free to follow me, and I would love to hear from you and follow you and develop my own personal learning network through different librarians that are attending these webinars, and great way to just share connections and build our knowledge base. So again, thank you, and enjoy the rest of your day.